This chapter will explain about fluid machinery, and this is a new chapter, which is a chapter 4. For this fluid machinery, we will deal with application of fluid mechanics. In previous chapter, we just learn how we just learn about theory, how to apply the momentum equation or Navier-Stokes equation. And then for this chapter, we will apply for the application. Okay, so basically this fluid machinery, or we can call as turbo machinery. Okay, in this chapter we will deal with pumps and turbine. Okay, so basically for this chapter, we will cover how to design a pump, okay, how to design a pump using a given equation, and then based on that equation you will come up with a graph, okay, and then you will come up with the solution, how to find a best or how to find the optimum design point in order to select or to choose the pump. Okay, so that we'll cover in this chapter. So basically content for this chapter, first classification of turbo machine, and then elementary of pump and turbine theories, and then the most important parts in this chapter is you need to understand the velocity triangles. Okay, so basically in this velocity triangle, you need to determine the absolute velocity that produced from the pump, from the blade of the pump, that is as a result of the summation of W, which is the relative velocity, and then U, the blade velocity. Okay, and then we also cover about the centrifugal pump. Okay, and then performance curve. In this performance curve, you can identify the optimum design point in order to choose the pump based on performance curve. And then axial flow pump, and this is the second type of pump, which is axial flow pump. And then this will come up with a performance curve. And then this is how to design pump in order to increase the capacity of the pump, so that we can arrange the pump in parallel and also in series. And then the second part of this chapter will talk about turbine, and then type of turbine, which is radial flow and axial flow turbine, and then the last one is impulse turbine. Okay, let's start with the some introduction for this fluid machinery. Okay, as you can see in this picture, okay, so we have two kind of fluid machine, which is positive displacement and also turbo machine. Okay, so for the turbo machine, it is basically a mechanical device that either extract energy from a fluid and also add energy to the a fluid. Okay, so that was a turbo machine. And then for the positive displacement, as you can see, for example, this is your tire pump. Okay, so this is tire pump, and then human heart basically is also a type of fluid machine that pump the blood and everything. And then C is gear pump. Okay, so basically from this introduction, the keywords is how we can classify or how we can group it is a pump or it is a turbine. Okay, so now let's start with turbo machine. Okay, so the definition of turbo machine So as I said earlier, turbo machine is a mechanical device that either extract energy and add energy. Okay, so mean that turbo machine is a mechanical device, so both are mechanical device. That extract energy from a fluid. Okay, so energy from a fluid is used in order to produce power. Okay, so that is basically a turbine. Okay, so and then the second definition for turbo machine is to add energy to a fluid. Okay, so for this case, it is a pump. Okay, so in simple example, you can see your fan, okay, your table or your desk fan, your ceiling fan. So that is basically from the power from the electricity, okay, and then from that it rotate the blade, okay, the blade of your fan, and then produce the energy, okay, produce the energy or add the energy. So this is categorized in terms of in pump. Okay, so for to extract energy, for example, windmill. Okay, so this is example for the turbine, and then for the aircraft, your engine for the aircraft, for the airplane, basically it is a gas turbine engine. Okay, so mean that we use the fluid, okay, use the fluid, extract the energy from the fluid in order to produce the power. Okay, so both will come out with the power. Okay, so power in terms of watts, joule per second. So it is in term, we can classify, we can use the notation of W dot. So that is for the turbo machine. Okay, so now we start with pump. Okay, so pump extract the energy. So turbo machine involve a collection of blades, okay, buckets, flow channels or passage arranged around an axis of rotation to form a rotor. Okay, and then turbo machine are mechanical device that either extract energy from a fluid, which is a turbine, or add energy to a fluid pump as a result of dynamic interaction between the device and the fluid. Okay, so turbo machine can be classified as axial flow, mixed flow, or radial flow. So mixed flow means that it is a combination between axial and radial flow. Okay, so now for the next page, what is axial flow and what is radial flow? Okay, so this is a centrifugal pump. Okay, so as you can see, this is a centrifugal pump. Okay, so as you can see, for this centrifugal pump, it consists of this. This is a casing, okay, casing, and then this is impeller. Okay, so this is impeller, and then that consists series of blade. Okay, so this is blade, and then this is impeller. Okay, so fluid enter. Okay, this is I. So where the fluid is coming from. Okay, and then due to the rotation of the impeller, okay, and then the interaction of the fluid between the pressure side and suction side of the blade, it will produce produce a higher energy. Okay, and then the fluid will leave through the outlet. Okay, so that is a radial flow, meaning that the energy or the fluid is coming in radial direction. Okay, so that is the radial flow fan. And then the second type is axial flow fan. So as you can see, axial mean that the direction of the fluid is always in axis direction. Okay, so as you can see, it is the inlet and then this is the outlet. It is very simple. Example is about your table, your ceiling fan, your desk fan. Okay, so that is the axial flow fan. Okay, so this is the real picture of this turbo machine. For the radial flow, and then for the axial flow fan. Okay, and then for the calculation, we will come up with the how to identify the velocity. Okay, so how to identify the velocity based on velocity triangles. Okay, so first we need to identify the basic energy consideration. Okay, so for this part, basically we simplify the flow analysis based on the velocity triangle. Okay, so I think most of you will think that the flow in the in such a device, pump or turbine, is very complex. Yeah, yes, that's true. The flow is very complex. It is three-dimensional and unsteady. But the essential phenomena can only be illustrated by use of simplified flow consideration and velocity triangles. Okay. So now let's say this is your fan blade. Okay. So mean that this is axial type of fan or pump. Okay. So it is rotated with omega, which is angular velocity. Okay, and then in order to come out with the velocity triangle, we have A, B, C, D. And then if you see from this direction, okay, so if you see from this direction, we will come out with this view. Okay, so you have A, B, C, and D. Okay, so in order to come out with the resultant velocity, which is v basically is an absolute velocity. Okay, so it is the summation of v, in order to get or to obtain v, it is a summation of w plus, okay, so you can see the direction of triangles, w plus u. Okay, so that is the basic principle in order to find the absolute velocity. So absolute velocity, and then w is relative velocity. And then u is the blade velocity. Okay, so u basically, in order to find the blade velocity, okay, so to find the blade velocity, it is u equal to omega multiplied with radius. Okay, so mean that radius for inlet and radius for outlet, r1 and r2. Okay, so what is absolute velocity, what is relative velocity? Okay, so for the absolute velocity, basically you can imagine that by sitting stationary at the blade on which the fan rests. Okay, so there is the absolute velocity. And then for the relative velocity, you can imagine that you are now at this blade. Okay, so mean that the relative velocity will always acting tangential to the blade. Okay, so you can see here, for example, this is point one, that is for inlet. Okay, so this is point one, and then this is point two. Okay, from this view, you will come up with this kind of profile for the blade profile. So the motion is in this direction. Okay, so always in the counterclockwise direction for this case. Okay, you can see the relative velocity, it is always tangential to the blade. So at the inlet W1, and then at the outlet W2, it is tangential to the point two. Okay, so that is the W, which is relative velocity. Now for the U1, which is the blade velocity, see, blade velocity pointing downwards. Okay, so this is U1, and then for the same for the U2, pointing downwards. Okay, and then as a result, W plus with U, you will come out with the V, which is the absolute velocity. The same goes here, W plus with U, you will come out with the absolute velocity at the inlet. Normally, to simplify the analysis, we can assume, but not often. So we can, it is depend on the question, it is depend on the problem. So we can assume that velocity is enter the fluid in axial or in the radial direction. Mean that no such it will enter with the theta equal to 90 degree. Okay, and then in order to produce or to produce the energy, we design the blade so that the absolute velocity at the outlet will come out with the summation of tangential, okay, so V theta and also V radial. Okay, so as you can see, for the V2, the absolute velocity at the outlet, there is a summation of there is component of tangential and component of the radial, so that in order to produce energy, the absolute velocity at point two cannot always in the 90 degree. Okay, so if it is 90 degree, mean that the velocity at the inlet and outlet is similar. Okay, so not add energy to the fluid. Okay, so for the next slide. Okay, so this is more same basically same slide as before. Okay, so this is what we call velocity triangle. Okay, there was velocity triangle where the absolute velocity is summation of relative velocity plus blade speed or blade velocity. Okay, so now I want to first we can identify the blade or the turbomachine is pump or turbine based on the absolute velocity. Okay, so as you can see here, you can see the blade motion. Okay, the blade motion is pointing downwards. Okay, direction is downwards, and then in order to find or in order to know to identify your turbomachine is either pump or turbine, you can it can be classified based on the absolute velocity at the outlet. Okay, so for example, now the absolute velocity, okay, it is in this direction, but basically it is the summation of tangential velocity, v tangential, and also v radial. Okay, so now you can see that the direction of absolute velocity at the outlet is in the similar direction for the blade motion. Okay, so for this case, okay, for this case, it can be classified as a pump. Okay, so this turbo machine is basically a pump. Okay, so if let's say your direction, okay, now if you design, you come up with this turbo machine, and then the velocity, the tangential velocity, is pointing on this direction. Okay, so mean that it is on not in a similar direction with the blade motion, so it is a turbine. Okay, so this is how to group your turbo machine based on velocity triangle. Okay, so now let's see the turbine. Okay, so this is a windmill blade geometry. Okay, so mean that for windmill, we use the energy, okay, we use the wind speed, okay, we use the wind speed in order to produce the energy, okay, to produce electricity, for example. Okay, now the blade is rotating in this direction, in a positive, in clockwise direction, and then from this, you can see from a side view, you will see this direction, you will see this figure. Okay, so now the coming velocity, the inlet, the wind coming from this direction, and then this is point 1 and point 2. Okay, so it is always point 1 and point 2, and then the view, the blade direction of blade profile is like this. Okay, and then this is the blade motion. Now, as I said, W is the relative velocity. It is always tangential to the inlet. Okay, so mean that it will be tangential. So this is W1, and then U is the blade motion. Okay, so this is blade motion. This is blade motion U1 and U2, and then in order to obtain absolute velocity, okay, so as I said, normally at the inlet it is no tangential velocity, so it enters 90 degree direction, so you it is v1. Now for at the outlet point 2, this is relative velocity, and then this is u, which is blade motion or blade velocity. Okay, so in order to obtain the resultant or the absolute velocity, W plus U2, so V2 basically equal to W2 plus U2. Okay, so now as you can see, the direction, it is a combination between V tangential and also VR. Okay, so now the direction of absolute velocity is not in a similar direction of blade motion. So for this case, we can classify as a turbine. Okay, so this is how to differentiate between turbine and also pump. Okay, so now we will come out with basic angular momentum. So from this basic angular momentum, we will come out with what we call Euler turbomachine equation. Okay, so in order to obtain in order to obtain the power produced from the pump or turbine. Okay, so power mean that in joule per second or watts ataupun kilowatt. Okay, so for steady flow, we always refer as steady flow. R multiply with R multiply with F basically torque. Okay, so one is the sum of the external torque or moment, and then the second number two is R multiply with the velocity vector, rho multiply with velocity vector normal to the differentiate with the area, which is known as the net rate of moment of momentum or angular momentum through the control surface. Okay, so basic angular momentum, first we will come up, since we are dealing with rotating, we have shaft, we're dealing with rotating shaft, so we need to identify, or we need to find what is the torque applied from the shaft, what is the shaft torque applied to the content of the control volume. Okay, so the first equation that we need to know is about the torque for the shaft. Okay, equation number one. So the axial component of this equation, applied to the one-dimensional simplification of flow through a turbomachine rotor. Okay, so in order to obtain the torque, which is we can determine based on m dot, which is mass flow rate at the inlet and then mass flow rate at the outlet. R1 is radius at the inlet, and then v theta 1 is tangential velocity for the inlet, and then tangential velocity at the outlet. Okay, as I said before, if the inlet velocity, the tangential inlet velocity, the inlet stay coming in either axial or radial direction, mean that in 90 degree, the theta is 90 degree, the angle is 90 degree, so no such tangential velocity, so we can cancel out the tangential velocity or the inlet parameter for the v theta 1. Okay, but this is not always true, it is depend on the problem. Okay, so T shaft is the shaft torque applied to the content of the control volume, and then negative is associated with mass flow rate enter. Okay, so as you can see before in our velocity triangle, at one we classify, we one is referred to the inlet, two is referred to the outlet. Okay, so negative, that's why it is negative, mass flow rate negative or enter, it is inflow, and then positive is outflow from the control volume. So this equation known as Euler turbomachine equation. Okay, so from the top we can identify the power produced from the shaft. Okay, or shaft power, which is related to the shaft torque and angular velocity. Okay, so typo here, so basically it is w dot, which is power. If it is related to w dot, mean that the unit must be joule per second or watts. Okay, so in order to identify to calculate the shaft power or the work produced, we can calculate based on the shaft torque multiplied with the omega. Okay, so from the previous slide, torque from the shaft, torque produced from the shaft is equal to negative m1 r1 v theta 1 plus m2 r2 v theta 2. Okay, we know that u is the blade velocity, okay, it is equal to omega r. Okay, so now W dot shaft, okay, so omega equal to U over R. Okay, you can substitute omega equal to U over R, and then you can cancel R. Last, you can obtain the work produced from the shaft equal to M dot, negative M dot for the inlet. Mass flow rate at the inlet equal to U1, which is the blade velocity, and tangent shell velocity at 1, plus M.2, which is mass flow rate at the outlet, blade velocity multiplied with the tangent shell velocity at 2. Okay, and then in terms of unit mass, mean that W dot per M dot, you will come up with U1 V theta 1 plus U2 V theta 2. Okay, so this is in joule. Okay, so not over second. Okay, so from the basic angular momentum from the velocity triangle, we can come up with this solution, with this conclusion. Okay, So V square, so this is V square, which is V equal to absolute velocity. Equal to V theta or Vx, okay, Vx square plus V theta square, okay, or we can rearrange Vx square equal to V square minus V theta square. Okay, so Vx square also equal to V theta minus U square, which is here. V theta minus U square is this direction, that is length. V theta minus U square, and then equal to W square for the small triangle. Okay, rearrange. We can obtain V theta U equal to V square plus U square minus W square, or we can come up with the work from the shaft, W shaft equal to V square, V2 at the outlet, V1 is for the inlet, U2 is U at the outlet and U at the inlet, okay, divided by 2. Okay, so from this equation, we can conclude that the power and the shaft work per unit mass can be obtained from the speed of the blade, which is U, and then the absolute velocity, the absolute fluid speed, which is V, and also the fluid speed relative to the blade, which is W. Okay, so there was basic angular momentum. Okay, so you need to, for this chapter, we'll always deal with this kind of equation. Okay, shaft power and then work produced or power produced from the pump or turbine. Okay, so now proceed to the first part of pump, which is centrifugal pump. Okay, so for this centrifugal pump, it is one of the most common radial type flow turbo machine. Okay, which is we known as a centrifugal pump. Okay, so this type of pump has two main components, which is an impeller. You can see here. This is impeller, and then which is attached to a rotating shaft. Okay, so this is a rotating shaft, and a stationary casing. So this is casing, housing casing ataupun housing ataupun volute which is enclosed the impeller, and then around the impeller it will consist of a number of blade, okay, number of blade usually curve, also sometimes called vanes, okay, blade or vanes arranged in a regular pattern around the shaft. So as the impeller rotate with the shaft, with the rotating shaft, fluid is sucked, okay, sucked in through the eye, okay, through the eye of the casing, and flows radially outward, okay, so the flow will radially outward. So that's why it is categorized as a radial flow turbomachine. Energy is added to the fluid by rotating blade. So energy is added to the fluid by rotating blade, and both pressure, okay, pressure and absolute velocity are increased as the fluid flow from the eye to the periphery of the blade. Okay, so pressure and absolute velocity increase. For the simplest type of centrifugal pump, the fluid discharge, okay, the fluid will come out from this outlet vane, from this outlet, the fluid discharge directly into a volute shaped casing. Okay, so fluid, the high energy of fluid will discharge through this volute shaped casing. The casing shape is designed to reduce the velocity as the fluid leaves the impeller. Okay, so as I said before, the velocity leave this impeller at very high speed and very high pressure. So in order to reduce the velocity, okay, in order to reduce velocity, the casing shape is designed to reduce the velocity as the fluid leaves the impeller, and this will decrease the kinetic energy. In kinetic energy is converted into an increase in pressure. Okay, so pressure will increase around this casing. Okay, so this casing also designed so that basically this casing is increased in area, so the area is higher than the impeller area in direction of flow. So it is used to produce an essentially uniform velocity. It will produce uniform velocity distribution as the fluid moves around the casing into the discharge opening. Okay, so for large centrifugal pumps, a different design is often used in which diffuser guide vanes, okay, diffuser guide vanes surround the impeller. So the diffuser vanes decelerate the flow, so will decrease the velocity of the flow as the fluid is directed into the pump casing. Okay, so that is how the centrifugal pump is working. So now, from this centrifugal pump, we will come up. We need to identify the velocity triangle. First, the velocity triangle, and then we can come up with the torque produced from the torque produced or torque supplied to the impeller, and then what is the work from the shaft required to produce that kind of energy. Okay, next slide. So this is basically example for the radial flow turbomachine or centrifugal pump. It is open impeller. Okay, so open, so no such casing for the impeller itself. And then B is enclosed or shrouded impeller. So it is shrouded or enclosed by a casing around the impeller. And then this is a complete pump assembly. Okay, so this is complete pump assembly. So this is shaft, and then the water for okay, so now we will come up the velocity triangle. Okay, so now let's say this is still from previous equation. Okay, theoretical consideration, m dot equal to m dot, if you remember, m dot equal to rho a v ataupun m dot equal to rho a v is q. Okay, q is flow rate in meter cube over second. Okay, so the power transferred from the shaft equal to work produced from the shaft is rho q t shaft multiply with the omega rho q t shaft is rho q r2 v theta 2 r1 v theta 1. Okay, so rho q omega r2 v theta 2 minus r1 v theta 1. Okay, we know that u or absolute the blade velocity or blade speed equal to omega multiply with the r. Okay, so omega r basically we can identify rho q omega r is basically u, which is u2 v theta 2 u1 v theta 1. Okay, so this is how to produce or how to come out with the power transfer okay from the top from the shaft. Okay, so this is the velocity triangle. Okay, velocity triangle, first as I can say before, we have point 1 for the inlet and then point 2 for the outlet. Okay, so at the point 1 first we can draw the relative velocity, because relative velocity is always tangential to the inlet blade. Okay, so that's it is tangential to the inlet blade, which is w1. And then the second known parameter is about the blade velocity. Okay, so now blade velocity in this direction, so it is tangential to the casing. Okay, tangential to the casing, so it is u1. And then for the absolute velocity, it is combination between or summation of w1 plus u1. Okay, so now as you can see, in order to obtain v1, basically it is a w1, this is w1, so this is u1. Okay, so w1 plus u1, you will obtain the velocity or absolute velocity at the inlet. Okay, so now there are alpha. Okay, there are alpha, which is the angle for the absolute velocity for at the inlet. Okay, so as I said before, normally we can assume that the inlet velocity is the inlet, the fluid coming for to the inlet velocity is always in 90 degree. Okay, so alpha 1 is equal to 90 degree, so mean that no such tangential velocity for that case, only radial velocity. So beta 1 is beta, the angles for this relative velocity. Okay, and then for the point 2, which is the at the outlet, first we draw the relative velocity and then we draw the the blade velocity or blade speed, which is u2. Okay, so in order to get v, it is equal to w2 plus v u2, you will obtain the absolute velocity at point 2 or at the outlet. Okay, so this is work. Sorry, the power produced from the shaft, rho Q U2 minus V theta 2 minus U1 V theta 1. Okay, the shaft power per unit mass of flowing fluid is W shaft power W dot shaft divided by rho Q or equal to U2 V theta 2 plus U1 V theta 1. Okay, so now recall the Mendeley equation. So basically, this is Mendeley equation 0.1 and 0.2. From the Mendeley equation, we will come out with the head. Okay, basically, we can, if you recall MEC441, we can. We often describe the energy equation in terms of H. Okay, H is H. Okay, HP means that H for the pump, and then HL is H for the losses. Okay, so losses due to the friction, and then losses due to the pipe fitting. Okay, so just recall your. MEC441. Okay, so the ideal or maximum head rise possible, which is head for the pump, is found from this Bernoulli equation. Okay, so recall that for the maximum for the head for the pump equal to W dot shaft. Okay, W dot here. Equal to rho GH, okay, or rho GQHP, which is head for the pump. Okay, so head for the pump basically equal to 1 over G. Okay, head for the pump, this is cancel out G, equal to U2 E theta 2 minus U1 V theta 1. Okay, so we will do this example after this. Okay, so from that equation, head for the pump, which is the ideal head rise. Okay, the is the amount of the energy per unit weight of the fluid added to the fluid by pump. Okay, so H pump equal to 1 over 2G V square minus V1 square plus U2 square minus U1 square plus W1 square minus W2 square. So mean that in this equation, we can identify the pump head based on the absolute velocity, based on the blade velocity, and then also based on the relative velocity. Okay, so from that equation, for the V, which is absolute velocity, which is we can classify as a kinetic energy of the fluid. For the second term, which is blade velocity, the pressure head rise that develop across the impeller due to centrifugal effect. Okay, and then number three, which is the diffusion of relative flow in the blade passage. Okay. So a relationship between the flow rate and pump at the head rise equal to HP equal to 1 over G U2 square minus V theta square U1 minus V theta 1 square. So everything must be depending on the velocity triangle. So as I said before, the fluid often has no tangential component of velocity, so V theta 1 is 0. Oswell, so as you enter the impeller. So the angle between the absolute velocity and the tangential velocity is 90 degree. So it is alpha 1 is always 0. So therefore, for the centrifugal pump, HP equal to 1 over G U2 V theta 2 okay, V theta 2. And then from outlet velocity triangle, okay, so from that velocity triangle, we can determine the beta 2, cot 1 over tangent or cot beta 2 equal to U2, which is here, okay, U2, this is U2, U2 minus with V theta 2, so this is V theta 2, so we will get here. Divided by VR, VR2, which is radial component of radial velocity for the absolute velocity, which is VR, VR2. Then, rearrange the equation, we'll come up with the head pump equal to U2 square. Okay, so rearrange this equation, U2 square over G minus U2 multiply with the VR2 cot beta beta 2 over G. Okay, so the flow rate Q is related to the radial component of the absolute velocity through the equation. Okay, so this is very important equation, Q equal to 2 pi R2 B2 VR VR2. Okay, so B2 is impeller blade head at the radius R R2. Thus HP equal to U square to U2 square over G U2 cot B square 2 pi R square B square G multiply with the Q. Okay, so this is equation for the ideal head pump for the centrifugal pump. So from this equation, okay, from this equation we can conclude that the ideal or maximum head rise, which is HP, for a centrifugal pump varies linearly with Q. Okay, varies linearly with Q for a given blade geometry and angular velocity. Okay, so for actual pump, the blade angle beta 2 in the outlet in the range of 20 degree to 25 degree and beta 1 in the range of 15 degree to 50 degree. If beta 2 is less than 90 degree, this pump is this curve or this blade are called backward curve, and if the beta 2 higher than 90 degree, this blade design is called a forward curve. Okay, so now we will try to solve this example. Where is the example? Okay, so this is the first example for a centrifugal pump. Okay, for this example, you have a centrifugal pump having an impeller diameter of 0.5 meter. So the diameter basically equal to 0.5. Okay, so mean that diameter. Diameter is 0.5 meter or R2 to 0.25 meter, and then operate at 900 revolution per minute, and is given 900 revolution per minute. The water enters the pump parallel to the pump shaft. Okay, so this sentence is very important in order to come up with assumption about the inlet absolute velocity. If the exit blade beta 2, okay, so beta 2 equal to is 25 degree, Okay, so if the beta 2 is 25 degree, determine the shaft power required. Okay, the shaft power, which is the shaft required to turn the impeller when the flow through the pump is 0.16 meter cube per second. So 0.16 meter cube per second is Q, volume flow rate. And then the uniform blade head is 50 meter. So blade head is 50 meter. So B equal to 0.05 meter. Okay, so I think I need to show you this figure so that you understand the blade head. Okay, so B or blade head is basically this. Okay, so this is blade head or B. Okay, so now the question asks you to find what is W dot shaft. Okay, so first, from the given equation, we need to find the W dot shaft. Okay, so recall that W dot shaft is equal to T shaft multiplied with the omega, which is the angular velocity, or it is also equal to T shaft equal to rho Q this sharp is rho Q R2 V theta 2 okay, rho Q R2 V theta 2 minus R1 V theta with theta 1. Okay, so from this equation, rho is for the water, we know it is known rho for the water is 1000 kilogram per meter cube. Q is given, flow rate is given. R2, we have R2. Now V theta 2 and V theta 1 is not given. So our first step, we need to identify what is V theta 2. Okay, so V theta 2 tangential velocity at the blade. But now for theta 1 or R1, this the water enters the pump parallel to the pump shaft. Okay, so mean that it is always parallel to the pump shaft. The alpha is always zero. So from this word we can assume that we can V theta 1 equal to zero. Okay, so V theta 1 equal to zero. So now we just need to identify V theta 2. So how to identify this V theta 2 when the blade angle is given? Okay, so just recall this equation. Okay, so this one, in order to find the V theta 2, okay, so in order to find V theta 2, we can use cot beta 2 U square minus V theta square, which is this length, over VR square. Okay, so now from equation, the blade angle equation, cot beta 2 equal to U2 minus V theta 2 divided by VR2. Okay, so how to find U2? Okay, U2 is the blade speed or blade velocity at the outlet. Okay, so to find this, it is easy because omega is given. So now first to find U2, the blade speed. It is equal to omega multiplied with the R2. So now U2 equal to omega. Omega is not given, but the revolution per minute is given, which is 900. So U2 equal to omega, which is 2 pi, which is radian per revolution, multiply with the n, which is 900 revolution per minute, and then we need to change in term of per second. So multiply again with 1 minute over 60 seconds, and then multiply with the R2. What is R2? R2 is 0.25 meter. Okay, so you can calculate U2 equal to 23.56 meter over second. Okay, so now you have U2. We still have unknown, which is VR2. So how to find VR2? So recall this equation. VR2 we can determine based on the flow rate, which is Q. So okay, so VR2 to find the radial speed, which is VR2. Okay, so VR2 can be determined based on Q equal to 2 pi R2 B2 VR2. Okay, so VR2 equal to Q divided by 2 pi R2 B2. Okay, so it is equal to 2.037 meter over second. Okay, so now we have U2, we have VR2. Rearrange the equation, we get V theta 2 equal to U2 minus minus with VR2 cot beta 2. Okay, so U2 23.56 minus VR2 2.037 cot beta 2 is 25 degree. Okay, so V theta 2 equal to 19.19 meter per second. Okay, so now we have V theta 2, we have Q, we have rho, we can determine W shaft, the work or the power required is rho Q. Rho is 1000, Q is 0.16 meter cube per second, R2 is 0.25, and then V theta 2 equal to 19.19 meter per second. Okay, so you will get the answer, which is watts or kilowatt. Okay, so that's all for today. Okay, so see you in the next lecture. Thank you.